Alex Dunn here, and today I thought I would, at long last, share 10 Easter eggs from my YA thriller, The Ivies. Because you know I created this outline a year ago and then never recorded it for release, but we are coming up on a very important day. December 15th, early decision day, the day that the book starts. So I thought, I'll do it now. And for fans of the channel, don't worry, my Ivy's editing breakdown is coming. The challenge is me remembering the whole period of dev edits and everything I did, because I find that I tend to black out the worst of editing. But that video is coming. I know that is a fan favorite for each of my books. It's where I go in depth into every single draft stage of the book and the changes that the book underwent. Kind of fun to look at that process. But today, we're doing a listicle about the Ivies. These are just fun little things that kind of I put into the book, and now you get to find out all the secrets of the things that I buried in the book, might answer some burning questions that you have, or possibly even clear up some misconceptions. Now, 8 out of 10 of these are completely spoiler-free, like they're inconsequential things that are not going to impact your reading of the story. So if you haven't read it yet, watch on. The last two are just slightly spoilery, so I will have a spoiler tag for those. And as always, these are going to be timestamped down below so you can watch and skip as needed. So the first Easter egg in the Ivies is Claflin Academy, where I got the name for the school in my book. And if you happen to go to Boston University, which is my alma mater, you might know the answer to this. Yes, Claflin Academy is named for my freshman dorm at Boston University. Claflin Hall at West Campus. Because it's always like you need like a fancy sounding name for your private school, and so many of them are taken. And so I was like, well, how do you name a school? And I thought, to be you, I googled it and I was like, haha, Claflin Academy. So no, someone once joked, is it named after Sam Claflin? It is not. It is named after whoever my university named my dorm after. The next Easter egg is also about nomenclature in the Ivies. So in the book, I have Kistner Hall, the Coleman Performing Arts Center, and Austin Hall. Austin Hall is the easiest. Yeah, I was just like, let's name an administrative building after Jane Austen. Easy. Kistner Hall is named after my friend Adrian Kistner, whose books are on the shelf behind me. Adrian wrote Dear Rachel Maddow and other books. Another Boston University connection, I went to BU with Adrian. It's where we met. We were friends long before either of us ever wrote a book and got published, and then we happened to debut in the same year. So I have known Adrian since 2005, which is like ancient. She's one of my oldest friends, and she still works in residence life at BU, and I was like, I shall name a dorm after Adrian Kistner. And the Coleman Performing Arts Center is named after Alyssa Coleman, author of The Gilded Girl. Was originally my author, mentor, match, mentee, but honestly is simply just my friend. I don't think of her, we're friends. And Alyssa is, in addition to being an incredibly talented author, also a playwright. I just think of her as a creative person, and I was like, I will name the Performing Arts Center after Alyssa. Speaking of nods, the third Easter egg, it's this offhand reference to a different prep school in Massachusetts that another character goes to. Actually, I think I made it New Hampshire. Doesn't matter. I called it Wheatford. This is a very oblique reference to Kara Thomas's first thriller series when she was writing under the name Kara Taylor, the Prep School Confidential series. It's like, it's not the same name, but it's like a wink nod to the name of the academy in those books. I just love Kara Thomas. The fourth Easter egg is Ethan, the cinnamon roll Canadian in the Ivies, the love interest and sidekick. He is an homage to a real person. The reason he is Canadian is because in my work as a college admissions consultant, in my pro bono work, well, she was simply my mentee. I was her writing mentor in Right Girl. She is Canadian, living here in the US, and so I saw firsthand that helping her apply to college, I didn't have to, because she explained the whole Canadian admissions thing to me. And I was writing this book and I was like, I shall base Ethan on you. But I created Ethan as an homage to my mentee. Basically, he is her stand-in, only in like the physical sense. Personality wise, they're quite different, but that was my little nod to my mentee. The fifth Easter egg, just, they're all basically nods for the most part. The reason Olivia is from Maryland and her mother went to University of Maryland, and that is a school that comes up in the book, is because my family is from Maryland. My mom went to the University of Maryland. I never had a thing about applying to the UMD because at the time I was applying, I didn't live in Maryland anymore. It wasn't my state school, but that is why I put UMD in there. And in fact, I have a family member who works for UMD. Now, I am pro UMD. I actually got a really hilarious question when the BookTube goddess interviewed me, like, what's your problem with UMD? And I love UMD. Olivia might have problems that are not, I would say, perceptually correct with UMD. I seriously debated an ending of the book where she went to UMD. If you've read the book, you know the direction the ending goes in, but I am here for UMD. So it's just a nice nod to my mom and her alma mater to have Olivia and her mom be from Maryland and her mom be an alumni of UMD as well. So the sixth Easter egg is there's something really early in the book when Olivia is working as a work study at Claflin, which was based on me being a work study at university. I took some creative license there. I'm like, this private school can have work study. It's fine. And some of the little jokes about the parents and the conversation she has on the phone on them are real. Those are based on real experiences I had as a work study at my university. Parents screaming down the phone, I pay $65,000 a year for this school. Yes, except in my day, it was $42,000 a year, but they would do that all the time. And I also have a joke about laundry, which is also real. I had a parent call me. I worked in an academic department, by the way, not student life. I had a parent call me very, very concerned about how their child was gonna do laundry. That was a conversation I had with a parent, and so I put that joke in the book. Though at Claflin there is laundry service because apparently Exeter has laundry service, and I was like, of course private boarding schools have laundry service. Colleges don't. You have to figure out how to do your laundry, or as this parent suggested, should her baby come home every weekend to do so mom could do laundry for them. So those are real jokes based on my experiences as a work study. The seventh Easter egg is just, I had to slip in a makeup Easter egg. There's actually technically a couple, like I mentioned, brands that I was into at the time that I thought the teen girl character might be into as well, because you know I have a Sephora problem. And specifically, I mention a lip gloss that Olivia splurges on at Sephora and knows that her mom is going to be upset about. And I just want to say, it's this one. It's Anastasia Beverly Hills Parfait Lip Gloss, because I bought this years ago and it is just I'm wearing it now. It is the most deliciously pretty lip gloss. I was like, this one. The irony is, during copy edits or proof past pages, they flagged it because Olivia's worried about the cost. And they were like, it's not that expensive. It's only $16. Now look, I guess that's true, but I know when I bought this lip gloss, I thought this was outrageously expensive. It's a matter of perspective. And so I steadied that because I was like, yeah, I could have picked a more expensive item of makeup, but I would actually argue Olivia wouldn't buy a more expensive item of makeup because I know when I was a teenager, I know that was the dark ages, whatever. But when you don't come from a high income family, you're not poor, but you really don't have expendable income, yeah, your mom's gonna be mad if you blow $16 on a lip gloss at Sephora. But that is why Olivia comments that it was the lesser of evils, but I think it is slightly outrageous to spend $16 on a lip gloss when you think about it, and yet I love this thing so, so much. I think it actually worked out that I picked this as the thing that she splurges on. Originally, it was actually that I had her buying a bunch of stuff, but I was like, no, it should be one thing, the one thing that Olivia allows herself. Because I think to a lot of people, it is expensive, and we mustn't forget that most people cannot just drop $16 on a lip gloss at Sephora. And so it speaks to kind of the class commentary in the book. So the eighth Easter egg is barely an Easter, I mean, it is and it isn't an Easter egg. It's, so let's talk about COVID-19 and the Ivies. You're like, why? And I'm like, I know. So some people really hate that COVID-19 is mentioned in the Ivies, and it was kind of a rock and a hard place thing where I was editing this book right as lockdown started, and as lockdown continued. And as we realized that COVID was going to seriously and substantively affect things, and specifically I was working on the book and realized I mentioned an SAT session that now doesn't exist because it's been canceled and we were in flux and those things were happening. So the long story short is I chose to include it and we're just gonna pretend that we live in a magical world where in the fall they could all go to school. It's fine, we're fine, but the like fun little Easter eggy type thing that I just managed to work in. So there is a joke, a COVID essay related joke later in the book that was originally about, I was about a sports essay. Then I was like, if I'm gonna go for the joke, let's make it an inappropriate essay about COVID. And you know, I've made a whole video that I made after I wrote this book about how you should be really careful about how you write about COVID in your college admissions essay. And so that my little Easter egg is that I worked in a joke, and I'll tell you that my first version of the joke, my editor thought, I won't say it was too offensive, but she didn't love it. And so I rewrote it. I actually made it more ridiculous than the original joke. Basically, the original joke was too real. So I made it really ridiculous. And that is the joke about writing your essay about COVID that is in the Ivies. So 9 and 10 are semi-spoilery. 9 is barely spoilery, but we're gonna be careful. And then 10 is definitely a spoiler. So the 9th Easter egg is all about college admissions and kind of the things that I worked into the book. I basically was like, let's use my useless, semi-useless knowledge in this book. So it's just little things like the reason that Margo secretly applies to the University of Michigan is because it has one of the best musical theater programs in the country. The other really good one is at Carnegie Mellon, now you know, but like UMich is huge, and specifically I ended up having Margo go for University of Michigan because that is where Ashley Park graduated from, and I actually originally it was directly referenced in the book and it just kind of got cut out in editing when I changed the ending of the book because Ashley Park has risen to be one of the rising stars of Broadway. She was nominated for a Tony, she originated the role of Gretchen Wieners in Mean Girls, and I was like, Margo would look up to Ashley, and Ashley went to the University of Michigan. And so that is why that is in the book. And then pretty much every other reference I make, in particular, this is where it gets vaguely, that was vaguely spoilery, is Olivia's school list was very specific. I like treated her like a real student, the way that I would advise a real student. And that is why her school list beyond Harvard is very specifically tailored to her academic situation, but specifically her financial situation. So every single school that Olivia applies to in the Ivies offers merit-based aid, including the state schools. I was like, if she needed a back, this is the spoilers, if she needed a backup plan, where could she realistically apply where she might have odds of getting generous financial aid, where there were also really strong journalism programs? And so that is why she applies to the University of Missouri, the University of Georgia, UMD is her state school, and then I threw in the University of Alabama there, not because it has a ranked journalism program, but because they have automatic merit scholarships if you reach a certain threshold. And Olivia as a student would have, and so that would have been an opportunity for her to potentially get full tuition covered at the University of Alabama. As of this recording, I believe they still have that program. I checked on it a few months ago, but they definitely did when Olivia was applying. And in fact, if you are a journalism student applying, UMD, Mizzou, University of Missouri, and UGA all have really great journalism programs and offer merit scholarship opportunities for out-of-state students. So now you know. And last but not least, the 10th Easter egg is just a little thing, so this is full spoilers because it involves the alternate ending. I guess the previous one did as well. So at the end of the Ivies, Olivia is approached to participate in a documentary being made by a woman, and I say that it's being produced for HBO. Now it would be HBO Max, but HBO. And this is inspired by me watching I Love You, Now Die, an excellent documentary I've actually watched twice because I enjoyed it that much. That aired on HBO, and I watched it while I was working on this book, and it helped kind of spark the idea that how to like take this to like the next meta media level. Having a documentary like would really add a sharp edge to where the story goes, and it's what gave me the inspiration for the ending of like, oh, and she'd have to consider like how she plays the documentary, and it was all inspired by that excellent documentary on HBO. So that is it, 10, I hope, fun Easter eggs from the Ivies. Let me know down below in the comments, did you catch any of these? Were you wondering? Do any of these surprise you? Are there other things in the Ivies where you're like, what was that about? And maybe I can answer your questions. Give this video a thumbs up if you like it. I will make more behind the scenes content about my books. And if you're not already subscribed to the channel, go ahead and do that. As always, guys, thank you so much for watching and happy writing.